Hello everyone, welcome to the another episode of Automation Hangout. In today's session, we are primarily going to learn about black box testing, and in specifically under black box testing, we're actually going to take a look at why test design techniques are required. So to start off with, we're actually going to give you an overview of what is that we're going to cover in detail today. The first topic is around what is black box testing. We're also going to take a look at how is that you would be actually writing test cases in a project. What are some of the challenges associated with writing test cases or identifying scenarios? We'll also take a look at some of the sample scenarios and then look at what are the different techniques that are available around test design. And then finally, before the wrap up, we'll basically look at some of the key benefits that you would actually get by applying test design techniques. We're not actually going to take a deep dive into each of the test design techniques in this video, but we'll be actually publishing a video in the next couple of days that will actually take you through each of the test design techniques. So to start off with, we're actually going to take a look at what is black box testing. So if you look at testing as a whole, there are two types of testing that you might have heard about. One is basically white box testing, where you may have access to the code of the application. So you're actually seeing the code or how the requirements of a customer is actually implemented, and then you're actually doing testing. And this white box testing is mostly done by the developers. Whereas black box testing, you don't have access to the code. So your testing is solely going to be based on the requirements or the functional specifications that your business analyst would have written. So you don't know how the developer has implemented it, because that's a black box for you. That's the reason why it's called black box testing. So you don't have access to the code structure or the internal parts within the code. You're actually just doing your testing based on the requirements as well as functional specifications. So you basically have inputs that actually goes into an application, and you know what kind of processing might happen within the application. That is basically the logic that is embedded within the application, but you don't know how it is implemented. You know what should be implemented, but you don't know how it is implemented, because you don't have access to the code. And then the only thing that you will actually verify is the output, because based on what inputs you are actually giving to the application, you are basically going and seeing whether the application is able to handle those inputs and then give you the required output. So output can be basically like, you're basically assume that you're actually dealing with a ticket reservation application. You're actually giving inputs to actually book a ticket. And then once your ticket is actually booked, you actually get a confirmation message. Or if there are errors in the inputs that you have given, again you get an output. In this case, it can be an error message. So you don't actually know how the developer has actually coded this, but based on the requirement specification, you go and verify whether the ticket booking is actually happening or not. That is what is covered in black box testing. Let's actually take an example of black box testing technique. So assume that you have an application that is actually going and that will actually have the ability to actually tell you whether you're eligible for vaccines. So the basic input that this application would actually take is a government issued ID number. It can be a social security number, or it can be another card number if you are in India. And what the application is doing is, there is a logic that is actually implemented within the application. So the logic is something like this: is a person above 18 years old, that is something that is actually being considered. And it's also looking whether the person has already taken the first dosage of vaccine, or the third condition that it is checking is whether the second dosage is also complete. So if you're above less than 18 years, you're not eligible for vaccine. And even if you're actually, if you have taken both the dosages of vaccine also, you're not actually eligible for vaccination. So this is what you see. So you'll only see, if you're doing black box testing, you'll only see the things that are actually written in the bottom side of the slide. But there is a code which is actually hidden from you, which is basically a series of if loops, where you're actually having an if loop that is actually verifying whether the age of the patient is greater than 18 and the status is not vaccinated. So in this case, he is eligible for vaccine, but he's not vaccinated. So he can actually go and take his first dosage of vaccine. And the second condition that is being verified is age is again 18 above and the status is partially vaccinated. That means the person has already got one dosage of vaccine and then he's eligible for the second dosage. And then there's an else condition, where if you're not less than 18, or if you're less than 18, or if you have taken both the dosages, you're not eligible for a vaccine again. So that is the logic that is actually hidden within the code, but you don't have access to it. You're just doing testing, or you may write test scenarios or test cases based on the logic that you actually see in the bottom portion, which is basically verifying whether the person's age is above 18, Your condition is, second condition is basically whether the first dosage is complete or the second dosage is complete. And then the output that you basically see is based on the conditions or inputs that you're actually giving. You basically go and verify whether the person is actually having a condition or an output is actually shown where a person can actually take a first dosage of a vaccine, a second dosage of vaccine, or the third scenario is you're not eligible for a vaccine. So in this case, when you're actually doing testing, when you're actually providing the input as the government issued ID number, the conditions that you may need to actually verify is, basically there are four different conditions that you may actually verify. So the first condition can be you may actually give ID of a person who's less than 18 years and you basically get a message that you're not eligible for vaccine. You may actually give an ID number of a person who has already taken two vaccines, and then again you actually get the message that you're not eligible for vaccination. The third scenario can be you basically give an ID number of a person who has actually completed the first dosage of vaccine. So you basically get a message that you're eligible for the second dose, and then you may actually give the ID number of a person who's above 18 years, who have not taken any first dose or second dose. So you basically again get a message that you're eligible for the first dosage. So based on the business conditions or the logic that is actually specified within your requirements or functional specification, you're actually doing testing, you may not be seeing the code. Okay, that is the difference. And now there can be out-of-box scenarios where the developer would have actually made special cases or errors while he has actually coded, and it is very tough to find all of those issues within your black box testing. For example, assume that there is a third condition where the person has actually done some manipulation where he wants to actually provide vaccination to someone who is less than 18 years of age. And what he has done is he's actually validating whether the ID, the government issue ID number, is actually hard-coded that within the code. And then if you're entering that ID number, you may actually get a message that you're eligible for vaccination. So these are very special conditions, but in a normal black box, using a normal black box testing technique, you may not be able to find this kind of errors because you really don't know what is there inside the code and you'll not be able to test for these conditions. But if you're actually doing something like a white box testing where you can actually get access to the code, that point of time, you may be able to find these kind of errors. So ideally, in any project, you should be actually having a mix of both white box as well as black box testing techniques, because you may not be able to see the entire code logic or any of the code logic when you're actually doing black box testing. So let's actually take a look at what is the general test design process. So in any project, when you're actually having a set of requirements or user stories, if that is given to you, the first thing that you need to do is analyze them to understand what it is. And then you may need to actually go and find out what are the valid inputs and invalid inputs that can actually go into the application. In the example that we saw, the valid inputs were basically an ID number of a person who is greater than 18 years of age, who has not taken a vaccination, or an ID number of a person who was above 18, who has already taken first dose, but not the second dose, or it can be someone. An invalid example of an invalid input can be someone who is less than 18 years old. So you would actually look at both invalid as well as valid inputs, and then look at how the system is actually going to handle both these inputs. So based on the code logic or the functional logic, in fact, you need to know what is the output that is actually expected, and based on the output on the information that you have around how the system would actually handle these kind of input, you're basically going to design test. And then once your tests are designed, you basically go and run these tests and then verify the expected and actual behavior when you're executing the test case. And then depending on the behavior, if it is not matching, you basically fail the test and then log the defect, or if the expected and actual behaviors are actually matching, you basically go and pass the test. But the key message here is basically it's very important to find out what are the valid and invalid inputs that you need to provide, and you should also know how the system would actually deal with an invalid or a valid input. What is the outcome or output that you can see on the screen or on the web page, or if it's a bad job, it can be maybe a status of the job that you may need to verify. So it will be very clear on how the system would actually handle your input based on whether it is valid or invalid. Okay, so that's a very important piece. And then the next important aspect, the key topic of today's discussion is why is that you need to use a test design technique. So in the example that we saw around vaccine eligibility. So ideally, if you want to test all the combinations of ages For example, one of the conditions that we have was had was basically the person should be actually having an age of more than 18 years. So if you want to test all those combinations, we are not actually going to test with a government ID number of a patient, of a person who's less than 1 year old. You're not actually going to do testing with, or if you're actually going to do testing with maybe like a person with the age of 1 year, age of 2 years, 3 years, you may actually have to do maybe testing till maybe from 0 months or 1 month to maybe like someone who's like 125 years old. So you have to actually look at maybe 125 different conditions. And then inside these 125 conditions, you may actually have to also have another 125, scenarios or cases where you may need to actually test a scenario where the person has already taken a vaccine. So you have infinite number of combinations that you may need to deal with. And it is not feasible to actually test everything. So it's very important to determine what is that you should be testing rather than actually testing for all the combinations. You need to actually look at what is important and then focus your testing towards that. So exhaustive testing for all the input parameters or all the input values is impossible, because you may end up spending days or months together even to test a simple application. So why test design technique is important is because we cannot actually do exhaustive testing. We cannot actually test all permutation combinations. And it's very important to actually determine how much testing is actually required. For that, you need to actually apply some techniques to determine like how much is that I should be actually testing. To what level should I be actually limiting my testing? So that's the reason why we have different types of test design techniques. So there are around like maybe I would say like 6 to 10 different techniques. So I've just put in some names of some techniques which are quite popular. The first one is basically called boundary analysis. Then you have a technique called equivalence partitioning. Then there's a third technique called decision tables. Error guessing is another technique, which is a very simple technique. It's all about, your knowledge as well as out-of-box thinking. You actually have something called state transition diagrams, as well as if you actually want to derive scenarios for combinational testing, you basically apply a technique called pairwise testing. But there are other multiple other techniques like classification tree, model-based testing, and all of those, which we may be covering in a future video. So today we're not actually going to take a deep dive or go into the depth of each of these techniques. We're actually going to have separate videos that we're planning to publish, which will actually cover each of these techniques in detail. So why I'll summarize on why test design techniques are important. Primarily because it's important to actually find as many defects as possible in a product or an application with a minimal number of test cases. So it is important to actually limit the amount of testing that we do, or the number of tests that we write. At the same time, it's important to actually find all the defects. So you should be actually looking at minimizing the test case count, but at the same time, you should not be compromising on the quality, for which a standardized way of designing test cases is important. The other important aspect is standardizing the test design process itself. Now, if I'm actually giving requirements or a functional specification to a tester A, and if I'm actually giving the same functional specification requirements to a tester B, both of them should be able to come up with the same number of test cases. That is not possible unless you apply a standard set of techniques for designing test cases. Otherwise, the test cases are actually going to be based on the knowledge or the experience level of the tester. So that is not something that that can actually work, because we cannot actually design scenarios based on the experience level or the knowledge of the person who's actually writing these test cases. So if you want to actually get the same kind of output when you're actually dealing with the functional specification requirement, you should be actually applying the same kind of techniques, so that there's no compromise on the quality nor on the number of test cases that you'd actually derive. And as we are talking earlier, like it is impossible to test everything. So you may not be able to write test cases for all the permutations and combinations that you might have, because that's actually not cost effective. So the test design techniques actually help us to minimize the test development effort, as well as the maintenance effort. Suppose if you're actually going to create test cases that are actually going to be a part of the regression test cases, you may have to also have to maintain them. And then it also takes time and effort to actually execute these test cases. So minimizing the test development, maintenance, as well as execution efforts are also important. So the test applying standard set of design techniques, test case design techniques, will actually help you to control all of those things. So you can actually find as many defects as possible with minimum number of test cases or optimal number of test cases, you will be able to reduce the effort that you're going to spend on test design, test execution, as well as test maintenance. And you're actually going to have a standard way of writing test cases for any product or application that you're dealing with. With that, we have come to the end of this video. Please share your feedback, and we'll be definitely publishing additional videos around this topic in the next couple of days. Thank you, and have a great day.